to Animals Today, your home for serious talk about animals. I'm Dr. Lori Kirshner. Big news for bird advocates this week as the American Bird Conservancy announced their intention to sue the government over recent regulations concerning the permitting of wind farms. As you know, these farms, which seem to be sprouting up all over the world, can and do harm eagles, hawks, and other birds. Today, we'll get two perspectives on this move. First, we will be speaking with Michael Hutchins with the American Bird Conservancy. Then we will welcome Marc Duchamp, president of Save the Eagles International. With us now is Dr. Michael Hutchins, national coordinator, Bird Smart Wind Energy Campaign, American Bird Conservancy. Welcome to the program, Michael.
Thank you, Lori.
Michael, the American Bird Conservancy just announced its intention to sue the Department of Interior related to the December 9, 2013 regulation allowing 30-year permits for wind energy companies. Michael, would you please, can you first give us a little background on this regulation?
Well, it's not been around for very long. I mean, the service they haven't actually given one of these permits yet, but they've certainly given themselves the ability to do so. What this will allow is for wind companies to apply for and obtain a permit to kill bald and golden eagles for up to 30 years. And we can talk a little bit about why we have a problem with this.
Okay, so the American Bird Conservancy sent a notice of intent to sue to the Department of Interior and the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service on April 30th. Why are you doing this?
Well, for a number of different reasons. First of all, we believe that the service went around NEPA, which is the National Environmental Policy Act, which basically states that before they take make any major changes to regulations that impact our natural resources, that they need to go through the NEPA process and ask the public and others for their opinions and go and really carefully assess the potential impact of these decisions on our natural resources. They didn't really do that this time. What they did was they went around NEPA, they claimed a categorical exclusion, and they simply said this is an administrative change, and it's not going to make any difference to wildlife. And we dispute that that contention. And the second reason is this change of rule is also going to involve what they call five-year internal reviews. So instead of getting a permit every 5 years where the public would have access to information to be able to see what's going on, there's going to be an internal review. And we feel that we're not going to be able to know what's going on at individual wind farms in terms of the number of birds that are being killed. We already have a problem with this. This is being treated as proprietary information. Public, however, does have a right to know. These are public trust resources that are being impacted. And, in fact, ABC currently has a lawsuit against the Fish and Wildlife Service for not sharing this type of information. In fact, the service did not recently share it with a Congressional Oversight Committee as well, which indicates that there is a problem with transparency.
That's right. Michael, what is the position of the American Bird Conservancy overall concerning wind energy?
Well, in general, ABC supports what we call bird smart wind energy. We'd like to see the federal government, however, adopt bird smart wind energy principles, and these involve careful risk assessment prior to approval, which leads to appropriate siting. We should be not be developing wind in major migratory routes or in key breeding areas or in sensitive habitats like wetlands or near wetlands. And we should be mitigating any developed wind farm there are ways to mitigate and reduce the impact on birds as well, and that mitigation should be required. And then that should be assessed through independent standardized post-construction monitoring of bird fatalities. And then if birds are taken incidentally, then there should be some form of compensation. involve, which might involve setting aside important habitat elsewhere or supporting important research that would be helpful for conservation, that type of thing.
Michael, even in these wind smart areas, don't wind farms still attract eagles and other raptors?
They can if they're put in the wrong places. And again, with eagles in particular, I mean, one of the great examples of a poorly sited wind facility is Altamont in California that's killed probably well over 2,000 eagles. And this is because there's a large population of ground squirrels in the area. So eagles are seeking prey, and they're not paying attention to the rapidly moving blades on wind turbines that can go up to 175 miles an hour, and they are struck by them while they're soaring and looking for prey.
Michael, is the American Bird Conservancy involved in advising or approving the siting of wind farms?
No, not really. I mean, that's not something that an NGO should do. I mean, that what we have done, however, is we've asked the Fish and Wildlife Service to conduct a national programmatic wind environmental impact statement stating where wind should never be developed. In fact, we have a map that we've developed showing important bird conservation areas throughout the United States. And this was funded by the New York-based Levy Foundation. And we would like the federal government to look at these maps, and we have red areas on the maps where it should simply not be developed because these are important migratory routes. They are important breeding habitats and sensitive ecological sites. It would be really helpful if the government would say, these are areas where the risks are just too high. We should not be developing wind here. Then in our orange areas on the map, great care needs to be taken with siting, and there needs to be individual assessments of these sites as to their potential impact on birds. But we know quite a bit about where birds move and what they do in the United States, and this type of very careful placement is the best type of mitigation that can be done.
Michael, what monitoring is done of wind farms once they're up and running to make sure they're not killing many birds? And if it is found that a lot of the eagles and falcons are being killed or injured, what happens at that point?
Well, this is a problem with the system that we currently have in place. There is monitoring done at some farms, not at others, but the point is it's all self-monitoring. So industry does the monitoring, and then they inform the Fish and Wildlife Service if they've killed any federally protected birds. And we have a bit of a problem with that because there was a recent prosecution of a Duke Energy, is the only prosecution that has so far been done by the Justice Department for the killing of federally protected birds. And so now we really wonder how transparent and, these companies are going to be, if they're going to be fined or, be forced to do mitigation if a number of protected species are actually killed at their facilities. So there are lots of problems with this. And, of course, there are lots of problems with the monitoring itself in terms of challenges, technical challenges, which make us think that the number of birds being killed is actually vastly greater than the number that is estimated based on counts of dead birds under the turbines.
Yeah. Michael, in the last minute or so, what would you like to accomplish with this suit, and what would you suggest to my listeners to do if they want to support this cause, please?
Well, initially, we'd like to go back to the old system of permitting once every 5 years, and we'd like to have transparency and public oversight of this process. And these permitting regulations should be mandatory, not voluntary as they are now. We've actually found out we've done an overlay of our bird risk assessment map now with the maps provided by USGS and the Federal Aviation Administration, which show both proposed and existing wind turbines. And it turns out that 8,200 turbines already exist in the red areas, and 4,000 more are planned, which makes us think that the voluntary guidelines are not working very well to protect our public trust resources. So there's some huge problems. I often say that the problem with wind energy development in the United States is that it's gotten way out ahead of the science and way out ahead of the current regulatory framework. So we need some changes, and we need them fast.
Wonderful. Dr. Michael Hutchins, thank you so much. He's with American Bird Conservancy. Check him out and see the great work that they're doing. Thank you, Michael.
You bet, Lori. Thank you.
Don't go away. After the break, we're going to continue our discussion on wind farms and birds. This is Dr. Lori Kirshner, and I want to thank you for joining us on Animals Today. Each week, we explore the wide variety of important issues concerning the welfare of animals, how people treat them, and where they fit in our society. From whale protectors on the open seas, to lawyers in court, to scouts helping their local shelter, join me to get the latest on animal welfare news, stories, and events from around the world. And visit us on Facebook to join the conversation. That's Animals Today every week, right here on the station, 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Also, make sure to visit us at animalstodayradio.com, where you can listen to any of our previous shows free. Animals Today brings you the highest quality, most up-to-date information about all animal welfare topics. Much of our support comes from the nonprofit group Advancing the Interests of Animals. Check them out at aianimals.org. That's aianimals.org. And thanks for listening.
Every day in the United States, tens of thousands of puppies and kittens are born. Unfortunately, there aren't enough homes for all these cats and dogs. One unfixed female cat and her offspring can be the source of more than 400,000 cats in 7 years. One female dog and her unfixed offspring can produce about 67,000 puppies. Too many cats and dogs are unwanted anywhere by anybody, so they end up being neglected or abandoned. Millions of healthy pets are killed in shelters annually. In the U.S., on average, 70% of the animals that enter the shelter end up getting euthanized. Fortunately, there is good news. There's a new answer to this dilemma. We can help to stop killing these animals by having our pets spayed or neutered. If you want a new pet, how about adopting one? You can rescue a cat or dog and save a life.
This message is sponsored by Advancing the Interests of Animals. You can check them out at aianimals.org. That's the letter A, aianimals.org.
Well, ring-a-ding-ding, the year was 1936, and Leo and Lillian Goodwin were hot to trot for the world to save some big bucks on automotive insurance. So they opened up a little joint called Geico. Geico had the goods for all the dolls and Joes who were keen on swell service and keeping the cabbage.
Flash forward over 75 years, and Geico is still helping customers save money every day and with 97% customer satisfaction. Today, the peeps would refer to that as pretty darn tight.
Geico, saving people money for over 75 years.
From helping florists manage their first payroll to checking sales projections for logistics companies to showing garages how much they've been paid to pursuing leads for multinationals, Sage Software helps businesses manage. Whether it's accounting, payroll, payments, ERP, or CRM, Sage gives you the control to look forward with confidence. Visit sageconfidence.com.
Staples has great deals on everything for your office break room, from coffees and teas.
Hey, boss, can I get some coffee?
No.
To sports drinks and sodas.
Hey, boss, can I?
No.
To chips and candy.
What if I?
No.
How
no.
About...
Staples has everything you need for your office break room.
But I'm gonna...
No.
Except the break. Thousands of products added online every day, even resume software. Now get a 20% off coupon for your K-Cup purchase. Staples, make more happen.
Coupon valid 5-11 and 5-17-14 in store online or by phone. Limit one coupon per customer while supplies last.
Breathe it in, kid. Clean, fresh air thanks to these new air handler filters. They're more energy efficient, hold more dust, and are stronger than ever. And Granger's got over 3,000 different styles and sizes to choose from. Just ordered a new batch from Granger.com today. I love oxygen, kid. And this facility's got some great AO2. I'm breathing easier just thinking about these air handler filters. Get some today. Get it? Got it? Good. Call, click Granger.com/air handler, or stop by. Granger, for the ones who get it done.
Welcome back to the show. We're continuing our discussion on the intention of the American Bird Conservancy to sue the federal government. I would now like to welcome a bird advocate who is not affiliated with the American Bird Conservancy. Marc Duchamp is president, Save the Eagles International, and chairman, World Council for Nature. Welcome back to the show, Marc.
Oh, hi, Laurie. How are you? I'm glad to be back. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm great. Marc, what do you think of the lawsuit American Bird Conservancy is going to file, and do you agree with their approach?
Yes, I think they're doing a very good thing in suing the government on that. We would have done it a year ago if we had the resources. But what we did then was to denounce the take permit, which is a license to kill eagles. So we did that a year ago, but we are glad that ABC, which has financial resources, can do that. It's an excellent thing to do. But we differ on many other things with the ABC, which is basically supporting wind turbines. In their press release, they even say that they strongly support wind turbines. And we don't think that their bird smart policy has a leg to stand on. We think it just doesn't work.
Marc, why are 30-year permits a mistake for the government to issue?
Well, they're a mistake because wind turbines are already killing eagles. These permits will just make it easier for the operators, for the turbine promoters and owners to kill them without prosecution. Before, they used to kill them and hide them. Now, if one eagle is found by an employee that's a honest employee, for instance, who will report it, or a member of the public, or an ornithologist, if this eagle is found, now, even if it's found, it doesn't matter because they can't be prosecuted. Because they have the eagle take permit, so it makes it even easier for the wind farm owners to kill eagles. So it doesn't really change much. It doesn't really change much the permits, but it's just in the legally it takes off all the barriers.
Marc, you mentioned you don't agree with these wind smart areas, or you don't believe in them. Why do you say that?
Well, Laurie, we Save the Eagles International doesn't believe in bird smart wind farms or wind turbines. And the reason is very simple. We have found that raptors are being attracted to wind farms. They see them as perching opportunities. For them, they are just like tall trees without leaves. And raptors love tall trees without leaves because they can perch on them. And from there, look all around, they have an excellent view all around, and they can see the prey. So when they see a new tall tree without leaves in their environment, they go for it and investigate it. So for them, when you have a new wind farm in any area, the eagles see it from miles and miles around because they have excellent vision and they fly very high, so they can see everything. And they see these new tall structures, and immediately they go and investigate them, see if they can perch on them. When you do put a wind farm, you clear the ground underneath so that the trucks and the cranes can come up and maneuver and raise the turbine. And these areas remain open areas during the life of the wind farm. So this creates an area where graminae will grow, and this attracts rodents and all kinds of prey that the raptors love to prey upon. So these are two things that make a great attraction for raptors. So the bird smart policy consists in saying, we can make the location of the turbine bird smart by moving the turbines and putting them in areas where the birds don't go too often. This doesn't work. It doesn't work because the raptors are going to be attracted from miles and miles around anyway. So it doesn't matter if you change a few turbines a few hundred meters here or there. And this is what is happening really in their policy, because first what happens is that the promoter selects an area where he has made a land deal. And once the land deal is done, then he is submitting his application. And then it's too late for the ornithologist to say, no, you can't put it there, you have to put it somewhere else because this place is dangerous. So the ornithologists, all they can do in their bird smart tactic is to move the turbines a few hundred meters apart or move them away from a particular spot that is very, very dangerous. But this is all what it amounts to, and it doesn't work, because if the raptors are attracted from miles and miles around by the turbines, it doesn't matter, that you move them a few hundred meters to the left or to the right, you see? This is the problem.
Yes, I see. So your position then, Mark, is that wind farms cannot be constructed anywhere. There's nowhere that they can be constructed or built where birds will not be placed in jeopardy. So would and even stronger regulations wouldn't protect the birds, correct?
It wouldn't. It wouldn't at all. The only place where wind turbines would be safe would be at the North Pole. Or at the middle of the Antarctica, where if no birds ever fly there. So this is the problem. And then you have a bigger problem even for bats, because bats are also attracted to wind farms because the turbines are attracted insects around them. The insects swarm around wind turbines. It's either because of the infrasound that they emit. It's either because of the heat that is generated by the friction of the machinery inside the turbines, or it may be also the lights when they light up at night, and then the bats come and feed on this insect. So there's a professor, a Swedish professor, Professor Ingemar Allen, who made a study 5 years ago in the Baltic on an offshore wind farm in the Baltic. He was studying the migration of bats over the Baltic, and he found that bats would stop at the wind farm and they would perch on the structure, they would feed on the insects around, and then start off again to the south. But he also found that some bats are coming from the shore, non-migrating bats coming from the shore to feed on the turbines, on the insects around the turbines. So the bats are attracted to at least that was 14 kilometers from the shore. So we can safely say that about 20 kilometers away the bats will be attracted, and the turbines are killing twice as many birds as many bats as they kill turbines. In the U.S. it's estimated at 30 million birds a year and 50 million bats a year. And these figures, which are not even recognized by the ABC, and this is another bone I have against them, is that they pretend, they always quote the figure given by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, which is ridiculous, 440,000 birds.
Mark, thank you so much. Mark Duchamp, president of Save the Eagles International. We really appreciate you coming on the show, Mark. Hi, this is Dr. Lori Kirshner from the animal welfare organization Advancing the Interests of Animals. Do you ever wonder what you can do to be nicer to animals or to help them? Here are a few things you can do to show your appreciation to our furry friends. You could donate to or volunteer at your local animal shelter. Walking the dogs and playing with the cats is a meaningful way to make a difference in the lives of homeless animals. You could be a foster parent. If you have the extra time and space, becoming a foster parent is a wonderful way to take some of the burden off our overcrowded shelter by giving an animal a loving place to live until their forever home is found. Increase your appreciation for wildlife by providing a welcoming space for butterflies, hummingbirds, and other creatures, or by simply driving cautiously through areas populated by wild animals such as deer. You are acting with compassion. These are only a few ideas to encourage you to continue thinking about your personal kindness towards animals. This message is sponsored by Advancing the Interests of Animals. Please visit us online at aianimals.com.
What is term life insurance? It's basically a financial protection plan for your family if you pass away. it can be a hard purchase. Think about it. It's one of the few major purchases you can make that you will personally never use. But you've got to have it to protect your family. And you owe it to yourself to shop and compare to get the best possible rates. For term life insurance policies of $500,000 or more, call the Term Lifeline today.
800-957-6068. That's 800-957-6068. Remember, we specialize in term life insurance policies of $500,000 or more, and we have great rates for smokers, too. So call today. 800-957-6068. 800-957-6068. That's 800-957-6068.
They say every healthy relationship should have a balance of predictability and spontaneity. In fact, it is that assurance of security that makes the spontaneous possible. Your relationship with your car should be a little like that too. With our new industry-leading unlimited mileage warranty, your certified pre-owned Mercedes-Benz instills a sense of confidence. You drive away knowing that you can keep driving for up to 3 years and never have to worry about the miles. Add to that our new complimentary prepaid maintenance on select models, and your certified pre-owned Mercedes-Benz becomes the ultimate carefree escape vehicle. Only during the Mercedes-Benz Certified Pre-Owned Sales event, going on now through June 2nd, can you also take advantage of a 2-month payment credit on many models, plus 3 months of Sirius XM satellite radio. So hurry in today. It might just be the most predictable spur-of-the-moment decision you've ever made.
See your authorized Mercedes-Benz dealer for complete details and limitations on certified pre-owned warranties.
Spring is finally here. Which activity would you rather do? Spring cleaning or spring travel? America's Best Value Inn is making your spring even better with a great deal. Save 15% when you book a room online and stay now through May 21st. Plus, you'll enjoy free internet, continental breakfast, and instant rewards at most of our 1,000 hotels in North America. Visit americasbestvalueinn.com and clean up on our spring travel deal.
If you're struggling to pay or haven't been making your student loan payments, listen carefully to this urgent alert. Have you been out of school for 10 or more years and you're still making your student loan payments? Are your student loans past due or even in default? Can't go back to school because of an old student loan problem? Fast Track Student Loans can get your student loans out of default, stop any wage garnishments, stop collection calls, and stop seizure of your tax refund. Give yourself a break. Stop the stress and get your student loan payments down to as little as $25 a month based on what you can afford to pay. One quick 10-minute call could help you solve your student loan problems. So call right now. Not available in all states. Payments may vary based on income.
800-685-0129. 800-685-0129. 800-685-0129. That's 800-685-0129.
I've had the hardest time finding someone who loves me for me, not my money.
I just want to find the perfect match.
Finding the right car insurance company can be daunting, especially if you've been burned in the past. Visit GEICO.com to find the policy destined for you. One devoted to saving you money, making your life easier, treating you like a princess or a vegan warlock, whatever you're into. Your perfect car insurance company is out there. GEICO. 15 minutes could save you hundreds on car insurance.
What's new, Pussycat? Whoa, whoa, whoa! What's new, Pussycat? Whoa, 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 whoa!
Welcome back to Animals Today. European zoos have come under intense scrutiny recently with the authorized killings of giraffes, bear cubs, and lions. In fact, we have learned that European zoos kill at least 5,000 healthy animals per year as a way of handling excess animals and in an attempt to promote genetic diversity. Now, following worldwide public outcry, the role of zoos rightfully is being questioned. One of the activities zoos claim to engage in is conservation, which would seem to be a laudable pursuit. In fact, a recent release of bison into the wild in Europe was promoted as proof of the value of zoos in helping wild animals. Now, to get one perspective on how we might view the bison release, I want to welcome a good friend of the show, Marc Bekoff, professor emeritus, University of Colorado Boulder, and author of multiple books and hundreds of articles on animal behavior, cognitive ethology, human-animal interactions, and animal protection, and more. Welcome to the program, Marc.
Oh, Laura, it's great to be with you again. Thank you.
Marc, the European bison went extinct in the wild in 1927, but small breeding populations were maintained in zoos. The first captive bred bison was reintroduced in the wild in 1952, and now the population is over 3,000. The bison are in the news again because seven more females raised in captivity in the British Isles were just released in Romania to join the herds and strengthen the genetic pool. So, Marc, what is wrong, if anything, with this history and the practice of keeping a genetic stock in captivity to support wild populations?
Zoos often claim that they're in the conservation business, and that's a laudable claim. They don't really do as much for conservation as they say they do. But one of the things that's wrong with a project like this, from my point of view, is just keeping the animals in cages because they may be used in the future. The arguments literally go back and forth, but one of the things that bothers me a lot is that animals are kept in cages for the possibility that they may be released into the wild.
So, Marc, the head of living collections for Highland Wildlife Park said, quote, "This is an excellent example of how zoos within the European Zoo Association's coordinated breeding programs are helping save species from extinction," end quote. Is he wrong?
Well, yeah, I mean, he's wrong in the sense that releasing and reintroducing animals into the wild does not mean that they're going to survive or reproduce or that it's going to have any effect on species conservation or preventing extinction. I mean, I'm sure I would like to believe he would agree with me. Reintroduction projects are very risky. There was a recent review of reintroduction projects published in a very prestigious journal that showed that mortality was one of the most important causes of lack of success, and there was mortality in more than 50% of all the studies. So just releasing animals into the wild doesn't mean that they're going to achieve any kind of conservation end at all.
Got it. So, Marc, what's wrong with saying, okay, we need to sacrifice, utilize, or even harm some members of this species to protect the future of the rest of its members?
Well, there's this growing field. It's an international field that really crosses disciplines called compassionate conservation. And what compassionate conservation offers is that animals should be respected and treated with dignity as individuals, not merely as members of a species. So one thing that's wrong would be keeping a lot of animals in captivity for the possibility that a few may be released, and of that few, maybe some will survive and reproduce. But really, Lori, what's also important is I, like most people, would love to see a lot of animals in the wild who are no longer there. But the costs are very high, and in fact, a lot of conservation biologists are really questioning what we call reintroduction or repatriation studies. It sounds good, the goals are laudable,
But when I read the summary of this project, you know, what came to mind was, well, this is great that they're doing it, but let's not put the cart before the horse, and let's not say that it's going to achieve a conservation goal. In fact, the probability that it will is low. If it does, great. But there still has been a great sacrifice of lives in order to do this. And compare and compassionate conservation, once again, would call attention to the well-being of individual bison.
Right. And your thinking has always been, as I know, and as mine too, that animals are individuals as your primary moral guiding principle. Mark, are there legitimate conservation activities performed by conventional zoos in the U.S., Europe, and around the world?
It depends on how you look at it. Because once again, a lot of zoos say that the reasons they exist are for education and conservation.
Right.
The education question, of course, is being pondered constantly because, despite what they say, there are no data that show that they really educate in a meaningful way. In fact, the latest study that was sponsored and performed at a whole lot of zoos basically showed that maybe under 1% of the people actually learned anything to do about conservation, and actually only about that number really learned that biodiversity was related to conservation. But the most important thing relating to your question, once again, is what do these people do with the knowledge? You know, what do these very few people do? Do they make contributions to projects, or is it just that they learned something? And once again, I'm not against learning. I'm a professor, and I'm very happy that people are learning. But the bottom line really is, do these people do anything for conservation? My take is that, once again, while the goals are laudable and people are trying to help endangered and threatened species, the data that exists don't support the conclusion that they are. So, for example, you know, all these elephants, particularly Asian elephants, who are held in zoos, you know, they don't get reintroduced into the wild, go on and make more elephants to replace, you know, say, a threatened or an endangered species. So I really want to be clear here, because I just think that we really need to go back to basics. We really need to ask what actually is happening. Do the people actually make contributions to conservation? Are these bison going to go on to reproduce, and not only one generation, but, you know, reproduce and develop a sustainable population? And the answer is, we don't know. And if we look at existing data, like I said before, it's unlikely that they will.
So what would you like to see happen at this point?
Well, what I would like to see happen, of course, is I would like to see traditional zoos be phased out. I mean, we're not going to get all the animals in zoos to go back into the wild. You know, people say, well, just release them. Well, we already know that that won't work even in these formal reintroduction projects. So what I think we need to do is recast what zoos really are and what they do. Of course, the goal for me would be not to have zoos anymore, and take care of every individual as if each life matters. Give the animals the very best we can, you know, give them. No more captive breeding. You know, you mentioned at the top of the show all the killings in European zoos, which, by the way, also occur in American zoos. You know, they're being killed because the animals can't be used as breeding machines. Stop the captive breeding with, quote, the likelihood that these animals will be, reintroduced to the wild, because they're not going to be.
Marc Bekoff, well stated. Thank you so much for coming on Animals Today.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you. Anytime.
Don't go away. More with Animals Today.
Ain't got enough dough to pay the rent. flat, broke, but I don't care. I strut right by with my tail in the air. Stray cat, strut, I'm a feeling Casanova.
As temperatures climb, please remember to never leave your dog in the car, not even for a minute on a warm day with the windows cracked and in the shade. The temperature inside a car can climb up in a matter of minutes, and it's enough to kill your pet. If you love your pet, leave them at home or with someone you trust. Keep them cool, comfortable, and alive. And if you see a dog or other pet in a car, you may only have a moment to save their life. Here are a couple of steps that you should remember. Make an announcement in the store or business the car is parked nearest to, and call the police department or animal control right away. Remember, it only takes a minute or two on a hot day to kill an animal left inside a car. Your swift action can save a life. Dogs are unable to cool themselves the way people can. Never leave your dog in the car, not even for a minute.
This message is sponsored by Advancing the Interests of Animals. You can check them out at aianimals.org. That's the letter A, I, animals.org.
Due to an upturn in the economy, Main Street Business Loans has pre-approved the release of millions of dollars in small business funding. Your business may already be pre-approved to receive up to $250,000. We've sent out millions of pre-approval letters. We see the economy growing, and our underwriters believe now is the time to invest in your business so you can grow faster and make more money. And we're prepared to give you up to $250,000 to do it. Your funds can be available in 5 days. There are no application fees, no annual fees, just quick access to up to $250,000. If your business did not receive your approval letter to get up to $250,000, call Main Street Business Loans Approval Desk now.
800-430-7570. 800-430-7570. 800-430-7570. That's 800-430-7570.
There is something about the road that beckons, that invites us to pack up the family and leave the world behind. And there is something about an industry-leading unlimited mileage warranty on a certified pre-owned Mercedes-Benz that gives us the freedom to do exactly that. You take to the highway, rack up the miles for up to 3 years, and drive with the assurance that your Mercedes-Benz is covered. You have the security of being in a car that has been certified to Mercedes-Benz standards, while you enjoy a carefree ownership experience for miles and miles. But while the mileage is unlimited, your time to take advantage of our certified pre-owned sales event is not. Now through June 2nd, you can also receive complimentary prepaid maintenance and a 2-month payment credit on select models, plus 3 months of Sirius XM satellite radio. So hurry into your authorized Mercedes-Benz dealer today and see why we say the odometer is there to record the memories.
See your authorized Mercedes-Benz dealer for complete details and limitations on certified pre-owned warranties.
When my daughter told me she was getting married this spring in Napa, my first thought was, to that guy? My second was, my allergies. That's when a friend told me about Advil Allergy. Turns out it's the only allergy medicine that relieves my itchy eyes and runny nose and has the speed and strength of Advil to tackle even my toughest allergy pain. So I could focus on the ceremony, not my allergies.
Fight even the toughest allergy symptoms with Advil Allergy, the only allergy medicine that comes with the speed and strength of Advil. Use as directed.
When my daughter told me she was getting married this spring in Napa, my first thought was, to that guy? My second was, my allergies. That's when a friend told me about Advil Allergy. Turns out it's the only allergy medicine that relieves my itchy eyes and runny nose and has the speed and strength of Advil to tackle even my toughest allergy pain. So I could focus on the ceremony, not my allergies.
Fight even the toughest allergy symptoms with Advil Allergy, the only allergy medicine that comes with the speed and strength of Advil. Use as directed.
Well, ring-a-ding-ding, the year was 1936, and Leo and Lillian Goodwin were hot to trot for the world to save some big bucks on automotive insurance. So they opened up a little joint called Geico. Geico had the goods for all the dolls and Joes who were keen on swell service and keeping the cabbage.
Flash forward over 75 years, and Geico is still helping customers save money every day and with 97% customer satisfaction. Today, the peeps would refer to that as pretty darn tight.
Geico, saving people money for over 75 years.
Breathe it in, kid. Clean, fresh air thanks to these new air handler filters. They're more energy efficient, hold more dust, and are stronger than ever. and Granger's got over 3,000 different styles and sizes to choose from. Just ordered a new batch from Granger.com today. I love oxygen, kid. And this facility's got some great AO2. I'm breathing easier just thinking about these air handler filters. Get some today. Get it? Got it? Good. Call, click Granger.com/air handler, or stop by. Granger, for the ones who get it done.
Welcome back. I want to thank you to listening to Animals Today and remind you, you can visit us on animalstodayradio.com. There you'll find all our previous shows for years are archived there, and you can listen through the website. If you want to sponsor the show, give us a call. Why don't you contact us? Email us at drlaurie@animalstodayradio.com. And if you want to speak with me with comment, a question, producer at animalstodayradio.com. That's how you can contact me. The show, of course, is sponsored by the group Advancing the Interests of Animals, and go to aianimals.org to see what's going on there. In addition to the radio show, there are a number of interesting animal campaigns, all promoting increased kindness and respect for all living beings. And let us know what you think. We appreciate it. In Dallas, I've got a couple. Let's just start there. In the a large district of Oak Cliff, they are dealing with many, many stray animals, and it's the main complaint of people at their city hall meetings. At one recent meeting, more than 50 people gathered to address the issue. People are afraid to really go outside for a walk. There are so many strays. So this really is another element of what we see in the statistics regarding euthanasia of adoptable animals in Dallas. And we really hope that they can sort of get it together. And also a greater reflection of the trouble that a lot of communities and cities in the southern part of the United States are dealing with compared to the northern communities and shelters, which do better in terms of getting adoptable dogs and cats actually into homes and out of the shelters rather than killing them. And the most recent data comes from 2009, and the states with the lowest rate of release, okay, that is the highest euthanasia rate, include Louisiana Animal Control, Mississippi, Miami-Dade Animal Services, and Dallas also does quite poorly there. So We just hope that they could get it together in Dallas and figure out how to handle the issue of many strays, which are really just a reflection of a small reflection of a much larger problem, and lots of elements need to come in to handle the symptom of all the strays. You can round them up, but if you have no mechanism to adopt them and they're all going to be euthanized, it's not helping anyone. In Los Angeles, let's move to Los Angeles for a second, and I can't wait to hear really the backstory on this, but there was a officer who was bitten by a pit bull and then shot the dog, who is not expected to live. Apparently, this police officer was issuing a ticket to a bicyclist when allegedly the owner of this dog urged this dog and another to attack the officer. Incredible, right? One of the dogs latched onto the upper thigh of the officer, who then shot the animal. And So we'll see really what happened there. But imagine a scenario where you are not the person being ticketed. I wonder if there was a relationship between the person who had the dogs and the person on the bicycle who was being ticketed that would make the compel them to go, say, attack this officer. Not a very smart thing to do either, right? Right. So I'll let you know if we learn more about that crazy story. I saw a cute video on YouTube you should try to check out, and that is featuring rats, believe it or not. And I have a new appreciation for rats thanks to our a friend and board member Bob Ferber. Bob is a humane education specialist, former L.A. Animal cruelty prosecutor and wonderful guy. And Bob has been using rats as friends that he brings into classrooms to engage children and to have them start thinking, you know, more humanely about animals. And he says it works wonders. And some of the kids really light up being close to these animals. Well, so that's why when I saw the rats on YouTube, I was ready sort of in the frame of mind to say, okay, these guys are sort of cute. But this video was exceptional, featuring rats, trained rats, walking on little tight ropes that were created, retrieving a coin for a little treat. Rats were trained to shake their bodies, to do a little spin maneuver, to jump through a hoop. Really quite remarkable what you can do. I know some people have pet rats, and they seem to be very amenable to training if you know how to do it and if you got the right little kibbled, right? In Muskegon, Michigan, there was a fire, and lo and behold, the firefighters were told that there was a reptile in the house that was on fire, and specifically a 6-foot python was in its terrarium. And fortunately, one particular firefighter, Scott Hemmelsback, had previous experience handling reptiles and answered the plea from his senior, from his seniors to go in and get this snake. So indeed, he ran back into the house and found the snake in the terrarium. The snake was trying to get out. There were a lot of smoke in this room, according to the firefighter, and he removed the screen off the top of it, and he knew how to approach the snake by coming from behind its head and grabbed it and was able to bring it out safely. And it made me wonder. By the way, he said he would do this for any creature. He was glad that it had a happy ending, and so am I. And I wonder if I would have the ability to go in there. I certainly have no experience rescuing snakes, but thanks to this officer. Well, I want to thank you for joining me on today's show. This is Dr. Peter Spiegel encouraging you to nurture your love and compassion for the only other being sharing our planet, the animals.
The opinions you hear on Biz Talk Radio are those of the hosts, callers, and guests, and do not necessarily reflect those of this station, Biz Talk Radio, its management, or advertisers. The information on Biz Talk Radio does not constitute a recommendation, offer, or solicitation to buy or sell any product or service. If you have any questions about Biz Talk Radio, contact us at 817-274-1609 or at biztalkradio.com.
USA News, I'm Bill Morrison. Texas Democrats say that President Barack Obama's anticipated nomination of San Antonio Mayor Julian Castro to be housing secretary could be something of a testing ground. Castro is widely seen as a possible vice presidential contender in 2016. Former Housing and Urban Development Secretary and ex-mayor of San Antonio, Henry Cisneros, says the nomination would be an important step for Castro. Eight people are injured after a bus crashed through a guardrail and fencing on an overpass near Boston.